Hello and welcome to episode 21 of the Victorian Studio Podcast. My name is Maureen and I'm coming to you from Winnipeg, Manitoba, Canada on Sunday, October the 25th, 2015. Welcome to all new and returning viewers. I hope you enjoy your visit in my studio today. Well, this week I have some knitting as well as some other Halloween crafting to share with you. I'll save the Halloween crafting to the end of the podcast, so if you just want to see the knitting, that's fine. But I thought I would share with you some pumpkin carving and Halloween decor that we've done in previous years. So I hope you enjoy seeing that. Before I get started, I wanted to send a couple of thank yous to fellow podcasters for their very sweet shout-outs. The first is Lisa from 90% Knitting. She is the indie dyer at Fiber Nymph Dye Works, and she gave me such a nice mention on her podcast the other day that she enjoyed my voice, my accent. I don't think I have an accent. I've been told by a few people that I have an accent, and they never think that I have an accent. Now, somebody that I consider having an accent is Nathan over at Sockmatician. I just love the UK accents, and he was very sweet to also give me a shout out. So that was very kind. Thank you both of you for mentioning me and my podcast. I also wanted to thank all the people who have become new subscribers and new members on our Ravelry group. We're growing every day, and it's just wonderful to see all of the messages that people have been sending back and forth in our Rav group, and all the participation in all of the threads over there. It's really been wonderful to see all that interaction between all the crafters over there. So thank you everyone for that. Speaking of our Ravelry group, if you're not a member, head over there and join up so you can participate in those discussions and also enter into the Toy Cal that's currently going on. It started on October the 1st and runs until the end of the year. So there's plenty of time to enter. We have a few more toys put in the finished objects thread this week, so I will go ahead and show you what people have made in this last week. So first off, let's see, there was a couple of toys done by Linnea, and she, her Rav name, it looks like it's Pack Northwest Crafter. I think she lives in the Pacific Northwest, so her real name is Linnea, and she crocheted a couple of toys. One is called the Lola Monster, and the other is Oliver Owl. So thank you very much, Linnea, for entering those. Sue, or Family Diva, has knit another Mrs. Bakery Bear, and that is a pattern by Kay Jones over at the Bakery Bears podcast. And this time Sue added a headband and a ribbon in her adorable dress that she knit on this Bakery Bear, with adorable shoes as well. So thank you, Sue, another wonderful bear added to the FO thread. Also, there was a couple of entries by Brittany. Brittany strikes again. This is B-Wing on Ravelry. She's entered before, but this time I say strikes again because she crocheted a little Yoda doll. And being a Star Wars fan, love, your Yoda. That pattern is by Vivian Russo Fille, and it's really adorable. Well done. Brittany also did a couple Blue Birds of Happiness. Those are some toys that I've also knit. I knit about half a dozen of those and gave them away to family members. I think it was at Easter time that I did that. And that's a pattern by Sarah Elizabeth Kilner. And I just love the way that you can use up small amounts of yarn that you may have left over, and they make up beautiful, beautiful toys. So those are great, Brittany. Thank you very much. Let's see. Maria or Seductive Berry on Ravelry also entered a couple of toys into the FO thread. The first one, she crocheted a little baby unicorn. Now, this thing is the most adorable toy I have ever seen. I'll put a picture here, of course, but you'll have to go over to Ravelry and see exactly how she did that. It's so, so cute. And that pattern is by Rachel Ho. And not only did she crochet that, she also knit a patch doll. That's a pattern by Susan Claudino, and hers is a white patch, and I just love that. She said it was inspired by the white pumpkins that you see around this time of year, and it looks so classy, and so does your little white patch. It's really adorable. Thank you very much. So I think that is the FOs that we have entered this week. You have until Saturday night, Central Standard Time, the 31st, that's Halloween, obviously, to get in any entries that you want to be in the running for the first of three monthly prize draws that I'm going to make for a $10 or less Rav gift pattern. So whoever has items in the finished objects thread by midnight, October 31st, I will do a random drawing, and I'll announce that winner next podcast, November the 1st. Can't believe it's November already coming up. And we'll have the first of our winners selected from those entries. And then those entries will also be eligible for the November draws and the December draws, and of course, the grand prize draws at the end of the Cal, December 31st, for the other physical prizes that I'll show probably next week again. So thank you everyone for all your participation, not only in the FO thread, but in the chatter thread. I love seeing all of the projects and all of the conversations going on in those threads. So let's see, I guess I'll get to what I was working on in this last week. I got a fair amount of knitting done, so I'll show you first of all what I got finished. And that was my mittens. So these are the Dainty Bubbles mittens, and this is a free pattern on Ravelry, and I chose this pattern because I love cables and I love the cable work on them, and I made them out of some alpaca, which is just the most soft yarn from Burton Alpacas. This was a vendor that we met at the Manitoba Fiber Festival, daughter and I, when we went a few weeks back. And this is what I have left. I re-caked that up because it was getting kind of loose. Now that I've finished the project, I've been having such fun with my yarn winder. Is it weird that I want to start a project not only because I want to start knitting, but I also want to wind yarn? It's so much fun to use it with my vintage Swift that I got in the spring at an antique shop, and also using my new, I think it's called the Stanwood yarn winder. Having lots of fun anyway. So back to the yarn. It is so soft, and it is pink because I also wanted to enter it into two knit alongs for October's Pinktober for breast cancer awareness. Those cows, one of them is at Penhook and Needle. They're co-hosting with Denise at the Knitting Den at Penhook and Needles, of course, Tally and Marlisha, my dear friends over there. So it's my final object has been entered in their knit-along, and I also entered it in Denise's at the Knitting Den's Pinktober knit-along as well. And that ends next weekend, so it was great to have that project finished and entered in those cows. And I also entered it in, because they're mittens, into Lena at A Wee Bit Knitty's A Wee Bit Mitty knit along. So the mittens are done, and I'm really thrilled with the way they turned out. And they're so comfortable and so soft. I really enjoy making these. And I also re-kitchenered the first one. I wasn't pleased with how the Kitchener stitch turned out on the first one, so I redid it. So those are both done with a lot better Kitchener stitch. The other one had a few bumps on it I just wasn't pleased with, so pulled that out and Kitchenered them both at the same time. So I knew I was doing it right. So as I say, I've entered these into three cals, and yeah, I'm just thrilled with the way they turned out. So because I got that off my needles, and last week I had a few other things off my needles, a little bit later you'll see I've casted on a few more new projects. But before I show you those, I'll show you what I'm continuing to work on. I did get a little bit of work done on both of my projects. These are more long-term projects. The first one are my TARDIS socks in my TARDIS bag, of course. And these are really coming along. I'm using the pattern Police Box Socks. And this is by Audrey Nicklin. Again, another free pattern on Ravelry. And I am using US 1.5s or 2.5 millimeter needles. And I'm doing them both at the same time, but not on the same set of circulars. Let's see here if I can find the tag. It's in here somewhere. Well, maybe not. No, I can't seem to find the tag for the yarn this week. But it's Briggs and Little. And the only yarn that I'm using this week is the denim colorway. I'm finished with the white or ecru and black. And now I'm just working with the denim color. I've shown that yarn in previous weeks, so. This is the first sock I got done to the heel gusset. So I've done the heel flap, traditional heel flap, heel turn, and I was just starting on the gusset. So that one's coming along. And the second one I've gotten a little farther on. I've actually am starting now on, well, I'm still just finishing up the gusset, and then I'll be starting on the foot. So that one I have the heel flap, the heel turn, and now I'm doing the decreases for the gusset. So I tried these on, and this yarn is a little stiffer than a usual sock yarn. So it was a little tight getting on, but they do fit. So I'm hoping that once I'm finished, I'll be able to block these out and stretch them out a little bit. I know they're a little bit tight around where I've done the color work, so I didn't know about Valeria's great suggestion on knitting inside out to make the tension a little bit looser on color work. So if you're interested in that method, check out the Ravelry group, and she mentions that in episode 19 about how to do that. So anyway, they do fit, although a little bit tight, so I'm hoping that they will stretch out. But yeah, I'm really pleased with the progress so far, and I'll continue to plug away at those every week. And again, anybody who's interested in the modifications that I've done for this pattern, you can check out my Ravelry project page, where I have an Excel file that's downloadable with the design of the two windows and a police box sign instead of the three that Audrey has on her pattern. So yeah, those are, again, there's no deadline for these. There are some sock cals going on, so I'll have to check out and see what the prerequisites are for some of those. And I may enter these in some of those sock cals, but as it stands, because there's no deadline, I can just work on them at my leisure. So enjoying that knit. So that's the first work in progress. And the second one is my cardigan. Last week I mentioned I didn't get anything done on my cardigan. in the previous week, but this week I more than made up with it, with a lot more work on it. So this is currently living in my Silver Shed bag by Ann Brody, and it's a nice big bag for a big project like this. So if you're new to the podcast, I've been working on the Roosevelt cardigan for a while now, and it's by Interweave, and I am using size 6 needles on this, 4mm needles, and I'm using this Wensleydale Sheep Shop long wool yarn. This is Aran weight, 100% new wool, and it's in their teal colorway. And I'm on, I think this is the fifth ball now that I wound up. Use my yarn winder again. I had previously tried to make a cardigan out of this wool, so I had a couple of skeins that I had just kind of wrapped up again. So again, having more fun rewinding it into a cake. So I'll be starting this cake soon because I'm almost done with the ball that I'm working on. I have completed the two sleeves. So if you're new, these are sleeves with cables running up the outside of them. So those were done first. And now I'm working on the body of the cardigan. And because I'm a fairly new knitter still, I would consider myself fairly new. I only started knitting last year. This is probably the largest project I've ever done, or most complex anyway. So this week I've been working on the body of the cardigan. So I was at, let's see if I can show you, at this little marker, that's where I was last week, or sorry, 2 weeks ago. I was just finishing up the rib of the back, and so it doesn't look like I've done a lot, but it's all the way across. Now, where I am at the point right now, I don't have needles in because this is the one side, I think this is the right side of the cardigan, right front, and then the back of the cardigan will be stockinette, and then I did most of my work still on the needles, working on the first pocket. So I think this is the left pocket. And while you're working on the pocket, you put the other stitches on waste yarns. So that's why there's that white yarn sticking in there. Just waiting to go back and work on that after I finish. So actually I have finished this first pocket, and it's got lots of cables. I hope you can see that there. So that's all done. I'm at a point now where I will be taking this off the needles, putting it on waste yarn, and starting on the second or right pocket on this side. And then after that, I believe then I'll be going back and working on the back of the cardigan some more. So yeah, it's kind of huge, kind of complex, but so far so good. I found that it's kind of daunting for your first sweater. I'm sure most knitters can relate to their first sweater or cardigan or complex project, that it's kind of daunting at first, but if I start to read the instructions and don't understand it, I just reread until I understand, you know, what it is that I'm trying to accomplish before diving in. So yeah, like Nathan says, the sock magician, just one stitch at a time. And yeah, I'm pleased with the way the first pocket has turned out. Now I'm hoping to make it deeper than the pattern, just like one of the other knitters have done on Ravelry. I read through her notes some more, and she did mention that she made the pocket deeper after she completed what the pattern did. It's actually in the back of the pocket that she made her modifications. So that's why I went ahead and went by pattern doing that first pocket. So it's really interesting to see just how that's all working out. So yeah, so I'll continue to work on this, and maybe next week I'll have another pocket done. I may be jinxing myself, but hopefully I can get at least started on the next pocket. And then I guess when I get to the back of the cardigan, there's going to be a lot of stockinette, but sometimes that's nice too, just to be able to sit, watch podcasts or other videos or movies or whatever, and just do a bunch of stockinette. So kind of looking forward to that, because sometimes when I have all the cabling, it's something that you really have to sit, at least I do, and concentrate quite a bit on. So I'm enjoying what it's turning out to be like, the design I'm really loving. But again, if I get interrupted or don't have kind of a quiet time to finish up, especially where I am, I find that I'm using my highlighters a lot. I will mark a pattern with highlighters as I go, so that's how I keep track of where I am on a complex pattern like this. So that's the way I do it. I guess other knitters have other ways of doing it, but I find that keeps me on track and not too confused on where I am. So, but I'm happy with the progress that I've made so far. So let's see. I think that is all of the works in progress I have to share with you. And because I did finish a few projects over the last couple of weeks, I thought it was time to begin a couple of new ones. So I thought I would share those with you as well. So the first one I thought I would share is a shawlette that Isabel at Fluffy Fibers. I just love her podcast with her sweet cat, and the most beautiful cat I've ever seen. She did a couple of designs. She's done a few, but a couple that I've recently purchased from her were shawls, and one of them is called the Bon Bon, and she is currently doing a knit along for this, so I'm hoping to enter this in her knit along. I think it goes till mid-December. Wrong bag. This bag has it. And so yeah, I'm really happy to be able to get another project on the needles that I can also enter into another knit along. They're fun to enter, not because I want to like win all the prizes or anything, but they're a nice incentive, and it's great to see other people's projects as well. So I really enjoy doing that. So this is the Bon Bon Shawlette by Fluffy Fibers, and you can purchase that on Ravelry. And I got some yarn a few weeks back just for this project. So she recommended using a sport weight yarn, and what I got, and of course caked up, is the Malabrigo yarn. It's just so soft. And this is called the Machita, and it's 100% merino superwash, 420 yards, and the colorway is 883 Sherry. And I just love the colors of this. I hope you can see. There are blues and purples and greens even in this. It's just incredibly dyed colorway. Really, really love it, and I thought it would make a really nice shawl. She mentions in her descriptions that she named it Bon Bon because she wanted something that was kind of like delectable and easy and a treat to be able to knit up, and it certainly is. So this is what I've got done so far, and that marker just shows the front of the shawlette so far. So I've done the first section. I just started this last night, actually, and I actually started it twice last night. What I did was, when I first started this project, I started knitting, and I learned two things doing this project. The first was, she suggested using, as one of the cast-on methods, Judy's Magic Cast-On, and I've never done that before. So she has a link in her pattern to the website where they explain how to do that magic cast-on. So no problem, I got that done all right. And one of the things that Isabel mentions is that you need a stitch marker for marking the spine of the shawl. So I did that. At first I had this blue one on there and I thought, it's kind of big and clunky. I think I'd like to use a really nice delicate stitch marker. So I used one of these, just a simple, small, round stitch marker to mark where the center stitches are to do the center spine, the yarn overs. And so I was knitting along last night and probably shouldn't have been knitting so late at night. It was probably about 1 o'clock in the morning and I was getting tired. And I didn't notice that because there are yarn overs, the stitch marker wasn't really holding them in place. And I got to about the second last row of this section, so about 26, 27 rows in, almost done, as much as I've done here. And I noticed that the center spine really wasn't straight. And I thought, okay, well, maybe it's, you know, it just needs blocking, right? And then I looked and I thought, no, there's definitely something wrong. So I started counting how many stitches to the center and then, you know, how many stitches on the other side. And sure enough, I had more stitches on one side. I had the total number of stitches, right? But there was more on one side than the other. Maureen, how did you manage to do that? And I think it was a combination probably of being too tired and also having too small of a stitch marker in the center spine. I think what was happening was those yarn overs were jumping over the stitch marker. So I thought, okay, it looked like it went askew just part way. I thought, okay, well, maybe I'll just, tear back to where I thought it was straighter, and started tearing back. Oh, forget it. You know, that's just too much trouble to try to figure out what row that would have been. And I just tore the whole thing out and started over. So I kept the larger stitch marker this time. And what I love about Isabel's pattern is that she also has a chart in here that shows how many stitches you should have at the end of each row. And what I did was I marked off every row. I counted either side to make sure that I still had that again. I'm sure no other knitter has come across this. Only I could do this to actually be so far out. I think I was almost 10 stitches out. It was just ridiculous that I didn't even notice. But luckily I started over again, got to practice Judy's magic cast on again, at least did that again, and it was fine. And this time on her little chart, I counted off each time to make sure that that center was in fact not getting askew anyway. And it's no fault of her pattern at all. It was just the fact that I had that tiny little stitch marker in there, and those large yarn overs were definitely, I guess, jumping over them, and I wasn't keeping it straight. So I'm thrilled that now at least I did it right, and I'm going to be on to the next section. So I'll have to take a few pictures and enter those into her knit along and let her know that I'm participating. So yeah, looking forward to working on that some more. And it's so soft, and I love this yarn when it's knit up. It's just really, really beautiful. So I don't know if I mentioned that I was using, let's see, size 7s, I believe, for this. Yeah, 4.5 millimeter US 7s. For this pattern. So yeah, I'm really really excited to see this progress. So that's my first new project this week that I've been working on. And the second one is actually a test knit, and that's for Lena at a Wee Bit Knitty Podcast. She is a wonderful designer of a few patterns. I know she has quite a few in her Ravelry shop. You should check them out. But she, a couple of weeks ago, asked for test knitters for a new pair of mittens that she designed. So I wrote to her and asked if I could help out, and she said yes. So I just started these yesterday, And so far she doesn't have a formal name for these yet, but for now she's just calling them braided mittens. And they're going to look like this. And these I'm knitting on 3.5 millimeter or US number 4 needles. And the yarn that I wanted to make them out of was some more alpaca. I just love my alpaca. So I had some in my stash. So I've started, it's a two color pattern. The cuff is one color and the rest of the mitten is another. So I started because I had some leftover of the Ultra Alpaca Light in this ecru color. So I started my first mitten using this. And so far I've got the cuff done. And I just love, it's a feather and fan pattern. This time I'm doing it right. And yeah, I'm just loving the way it's starting out. And I'm also using a different kind of stitch marker, a row counter. This is a row counter with 10 little markers, and it has a cute little cat. I don't know if you can see that knitting at the end. I got this row counter from a lady in Australia, and what you do is as you go along, you change your position in the circles there to what row you're on. So yeah, it's been helpful keeping track of how many sets that I've been doing in this pattern. So I'm really loving the way this is knitting up. Lena writes such a clear pattern that I haven't found any mistakes or problems with it so far. So I'm really enjoying this test knit. Now the second color, I'm not sure right now. I only had this other red Ultra Alpaca Light. So it's the same kind as the ecru, the same weight, but I'm not sure if I'm going to continue and go ahead with this red. I'm kind of concerned with it maybe bleeding with the ecru color, so I may go out and choose another lighter color than this red. So I'll check this week. If I get to the yarn shop this week, I may shop around for a different color. For now, those are the two colors that I've chosen. I may continue with it. It's almost kind of like a Canadian flag colors of a white and red, but we'll see if I continue to do the rest of the mitt in the red. So for now, that's what I've done on her test knit. So I think that's all I have to share knitting wise with you this week. I don't have anything that arrived in the mail for new acquisitions. So I think the rest of the podcast, I thought I would talk Halloween with you since it's coming up in just a few days. Okay, welcome back. I just wanted to add a few other things to my desk now that it was clear of knitting. As you can see, I have behind me a few pumpkins, and these are foam pumpkins that I've carved over the years. I thought I would share with you. Thank you, first of all, to everyone who commented on my Halloween apothecary from last week's episode. That was really sweet of you to send me all the messages and compliments on that project. I had so much fun making that. I have lots of fun at Halloween time doing all kinds of different crafts, as you can see, including pumpkin carving. Over the years, ever since we were married, actually, and especially when my daughter was young, we would have a tradition of carving real pumpkins. And what I'll do at the end of the podcast is add a slideshow of a few that I've done over the years. And I gradually moved from carving real pumpkins only to also doing a few that of those foam pumpkins, these ones that you can find at Michael's and other craft stores. I thought if I was doing more intricate designs, it was something that, you know, if I was spending a lot of time on, a lot of effort, I wanted to keep them. So I certainly didn't want to just do them for one night only. So that's what got me into doing a few pumpkins each year out of foam. And what I do is I just carve out a hole in the back of those, and we light these pumpkins using bulbs. We just use these kind of light bulbs that plug into an extension cord that then we run out the back of the pumpkins, and they work great for Halloween night. They don't get hot in the, you don't want to use real candles in the fake pumpkins. So I have a few of these that work just wonderfully for our pumpkins. So not only will I show you these ones here, but I'll show them to you lit up. They look so much better when they're lit up. So I'll add a few pictures of them when they're lit up in the dark. So as I said, we love celebrating Halloween. And when my daughter was young, we also loved attending. It was a kind of a event at our local zoo called Boo at the Zoo. It's not held anymore, unfortunately. Proceeds went, I believe, to the Children's Hospital and the zoo. And while my daughter was growing up, what you would do is, as a family, you'd get dressed up. You didn't have to, but we did. And they had all kinds of events and activities for the kids to play with at the zoo. So we had lots of fun. We went for a few years. And of course, being big Star Wars fans for a few years, we were dressed up as Star Wars characters. So if I can find them, I'll also add into the slideshow a few pictures of us dressed up as Star Wars characters during a few Boo at the Zoo events. One year I remember, I guess it was 1999 when episode one had come out. I sewed up a Darth Maul costume, and I've sewn a few costumes. I have a couple of Jedi costumes. I sewed up Princess Leia costume for my daughter, and I've also made Darth Vader and Stormtrooper costumes as well. But this year I made a Darth Maul costume and decided to go as myself as Darth Maul. And instead of wearing the rubber mask that I had bought, and it really wasn't really detailed very much, I thought I'll just do my own makeup. So I did that, spent the whole afternoon doing the detailed black and red makeup. Unfortunately, we took pictures of it, but Hubby's camera died shortly after, and it wasn't a digital camera, it was a film camera. And we don't have pictures of myself dressed up as Darth Maul, but I do have a picture of a mannequin that I made after this Halloween, and I'll insert a picture here. That is the rubber mask on him, but I have my whole costume on that mannequin. I made that mannequin myself, just using like a foam head and some chicken wire and wood and everything. Anyway, he stands guard to my Star Wars room. And some Halloweens, I even would put him at the front door and scare the bejesus out of some kids. But this one Halloween, the first Halloween that I made the costume for, I wore it. And had the makeup on, and we decided to, before we went to Boo at the Zoo, we thought we would stop by somewhere just to grab something quick to eat that we could eat on the way, because I think it was like a weekday. We had picked up daughter from school, and we were at working all day, so we quickly got all our stuff together. I had to do all my makeup. So we were kind of running late, and we thought, okay, well, we'll go to KFC and just pick up some chicken to eat. And there was quite a lineup at the drive-thru, so I thought, okay, I'll just run in and grab the meal. And they were actually sponsoring an Episode 1 promotion. They had all kinds of Episode 1 toys. The staff all had Episode 1 ties, and of course, all, you know, it was all decorated in Star Wars inside the restaurant. So I went into the restaurant while hubby and daughter waited in the car and got in line at the till, ready to place my order. And of course, I got more than a few looks, all dressed up as Darth Maul. And I really didn't care too much, because behind all that makeup, nobody could tell who I was. So I got behind this lady that was in line, and she got up to the counter and started giving the guy behind the counter such a hard time. She was being a real pain. And I just stood behind her, and the more she went on and on and giving this guy a hard time, the more I thought, I'm gonna give this lady what for. I didn't want to say anything. All I did was I stood behind her and I crossed my arms like Darth Maul. And the guys and the staff behind the counter, they were kind of snickering. And I was giving her this evil eye. And she, like I say, she was just giving him what for. I don't know what. It was something stupid anyway. She was being real bee. And so all I did was stood there. And she quickly turned around after she got her ticket for her order. And she stopped in her tracks and looked right at me and screamed. And I thought it was the best thing. The whole restaurant died laughing. She turned beet red, and I just like kept in character, and I thought, yeah, serves you right. I just loved scaring her. And from that point on, she was very quiet. And I tell you, the manager came out and gave me a KFC episode 1 staff tie. Now, this is something that you can't buy. This was something that was handed out only to employees. And they just loved it. And they actually ended up giving me all kinds of stuff from that restaurant. He asked me a little bit later for my name and contact information. And I think I ended up getting like the display and everything for their toy collection. So it was just hilarious. It was really a night to remember. And we went to Boo at the Zoo and had a wonderful time. And the staff, you know, got a big kick out of it. In previous years, we had gone, we had dressed up daughter as Princess Leia. She was really tiny, and hubby as Darth Vader, and myself as a stormtrooper. So as I say, I'll add those pictures into the slideshow after that. So suffice to say, Halloween is quite a fun time for all of us. And as I said before, I love carving pumpkins. And of course, because I'm a Star Wars fan, and I love Nightmare Before Christmas, and other geeky movies, not only do I do pumpkins in the traditional, you know, bats and Dracula and black cats and things like that, I also made a few of the foam pumpkins into some of my favorite geeky characters. So I thought I'd share those with you today. So the first one I did a few years ago was, of course, Darth Vader. And this guy sits in my Star Wars room. One day I'll share a tour of my Star Wars collection with you. But this is a design that I drew myself and then transferred onto the front of the pumpkin. And you basically just carve it like you would a regular pumpkin using the carving tools. But you have to be very, very careful to work with a very fine foam. So it worked out so well that I thought every year I would do a few. So this is Darth Vader, and again, I'll show you pictures of it lit up. It looks so much better when it's lit up. And then another year I did Jack Skellington from A Nightmare Before Christmas. And again, this is my own drawing that I did that I transferred then onto the pumpkin and carved out. And yeah, I really like the way he turned out. It's a big hit with the kids when they come to visit to get their candy. But the one I'm most proud of is another Jack. And so I call them my pair of Jacks when I have them together, because I have Jack Skellington, but also I have Jack Sparrow. So again, this one is the most complex one that I've ever done, most detailed. And it doesn't look like much here, but when he's lit up, and I will insert a picture of it lit up, I'm really pleased with the way this turned out. Again, it was my own drawing, and then I transferred it onto the foam pumpkin and then carved it out. And yeah, I'm really thrilled. I just love the Pirates of the Caribbean movies, and I love anything by Johnny Depp. So the year that I carved this, it could have been the year or two after Pirates. I don't recall exactly what year I did this. But I won a contest over at Disney for this Disney fan site for this pumpkin. And I won a Jolly Roger model kit. And so that was really, really cool to receive. So when I thought, okay, it turned out really well. I'm a big fan of Johnny Depp. I thought, well, maybe he would like to see the pumpkin and get a kick out of it. So I sent him a little letter and sent him a picture of the pumpkin. And I thought, well, if I hear back from him, great. If I don't, that's fine too, you know. But like 2 weeks later, less than 2 weeks later, I get this letter in the mail back from Johnny Depp. thanking me for sending the picture, that he really enjoyed it, and he sent me something back. And it's one of my most prized possessions. It's a Jack Sparrow signed autograph by Johnny Depp. And so I tell you, I literally was jumping up and down to have received this. So I have this in my spare bedroom. I have a bunch of Pirates of the Caribbean collectibles. I also have some Nightmare Before Christmas collectibles in that room, some others. So one day again, I'll share that with you. But I thought you would like to see, because of my Jack Sparrow pumpkin, I got a Jack Sparrow autograph from Johnny Depp himself. So I thought that was pretty cool. So I hope you don't mind seeing that. I have a few autographs that I've collected for Star Wars and that kind of thing as well. Well, a few, probably about almost 150 autographs. So I do love collecting autographs, but I tell you, the Johnny Depp one is got to be my prized possession. So I hope you enjoyed seeing that. So I think that's all I have to share with you this week. I will add a few photos at the end here of some of our Halloween decor from this year and previous years, and pictures of some of my pumpkins all lit up ready for the big day. So I hope everyone has a wonderful, safe Halloween. Hope you have a lot of fun. As usual, I overbought candy. Oh, so sad. We can get anywhere from 50 to 100 kids, depending on the year, depending on the weather, and what night of the week Halloween falls on. And because Halloween is on a Saturday this year, I overbought, I'm sure. But oh well, it's candy that I enjoy having too. So I'm sure I'll be munching on a few mini chocolates myself. So I hope everyone has a wonderful Halloween and have lots of fun and keep safe. So thank you so much for joining me this week in my studio. I hope you had a good time, and I hope you'll return again for another visit next time. So until then, have a great week, everyone, and we'll see you November 1st. Bye-bye.